Hello, I'm Kirsty Young. Thank you for downloading this podcast of Desert Island Discs from BBC Radio 4. For rights reasons, the music choices are shorter than in the radio broadcast. For more information about the programme, please visit bbc.co.uk/radio4. My castaway this week is the footballer Tony Adams. He's one of just a very few who know at first hand the pressures and joys of captaining the England team. And as a club player, he's the only man ever to have led a championship-winning side across three decades. Now as a coach, he's about to head off on a new journey to Azerbaijan, where he plans to spend a decade creating, he says, the Tony Adams side. He has lived a life of two halves. Sorry about that. True, his sporting success is legendary, but so too was his addiction to the booze. He even spent time in prison for drink driving. Yet his journey of recovery is as remarkable as anything he ever managed on the pitch. Aside from developing a love of literature, the arts and education, he's poured his own cash into a pioneering charity that helps fellow sportsmen and women recover from addiction. It's a transformation that former teammates have described as heroic. He says of himself, "I'm a completely different guy. The old Tony Adams had a lot of good stuff in him as well, but I wouldn't go anywhere near him if he'd had a drink. He used to be full of self-loathing, but I quite like myself today." So much in there, but let's start, of course, with the World Cup, Tony Adams. Millions of people tuning in. I'm guessing you're among them. Are you watching most of the matches?
It's good to be here, and thank you for that. That was lovely. Yeah, I'm catching bits and pieces. It's fun. I sit there and watch it with the kids, and it's very entertaining.
The big World Cup question, of course, that all of us are pondering on right now is, are you for or against the vuvuzela? Should it be there or not be there?
I've not noticed it. I did speak to a...
You've not noticed it?
You know, well, I look at a game differently.
Right.
More often than not, the sand's off anyway. You've got to form your own opinion. I've shut off to the commentators a long time ago, and even the punditries. Tournaments are very difficult. When you're trying to win the prize, I think the statistics are that the winners have only won five of the seven games. You know, so you're allowed to have a few games where you don't particularly do well. But you have to have the mentality to progress. Yeah. You know, there was moments of last World Cups where we've snapped into gear, you know. At any moment, you can snap into gear.
One last question. When you've been knocked out of the World Cup, what's it like on the journey home?
Horrific. Absolutely horrific. I got a lot of criticism in 88, and I remember coming back into Luton Airport and being chased by a load of... there were three coaches parked of England supporters, and they chased me and I legged it, and I won Fiat Uno Young Player of the Year in those days. So I had a little Fiat Uno and I legged it to the car and sped away, but it was horrific enough that the public was all on my case. But the type of character that I am, we won the league the next year. You know, I focused in on that and I said, right, OK, I'm going to prove to all you guys, actually, I'm a good player. And I said that to Bex, actually, after 98, after he got sent off. And I said to Bex when he was in tears in the changing rooms, I said, go, all you can do now, it's gone, it's finished. You know, we're out, this is my last opportunity and you blew it for me, thanks, Dave. But now what you can do is go back to your club and win the league for Man United and do your best for that. That's all you can do. And I think they did, the buggers.
Let's have some music then. Tell me, Tony Adams, what we're going to hear first of all today.
We've got Earth, Wind and Fire and Let's Groove. It's the first record I ever bought.
You saved up your pocket money, did you?
I did. I got 50p in those days, and I got steak and kidney pie and chips and 10 pence bus fare home. So I didn't get the bus home for a few weeks, and I saved up, and I walked down Oxo Lane in Dagenham. There's a new record shop that just opened, and I bought. It's kind of funky too, man.
That was Earth, Wind and Fire and Let's Groove. So, Tony Adams, we'll look at your family, if we may, way back. First of all, your parents, what was their story? Where did they come from?
Working class, the East End. You know, my father, he was evacuated during the war up to the North East, and after the war had finished, come back to the East End with a Northern accent, and his family disowned him because of it and threw him out the house. And my grandfather was a very cruel man.
Yeah, that seems a particularly harsh judgment.
Yeah, he would do things like the Sunday dinner, for instance, it fueled by alcohol, I think, a lot of it. But five brothers and a sister my dad had, and they'd sit around the dining room table on a Sunday lunch, and if anyone moved, he had a bunch of keys sitting on the side of the table, and if anyone spoke or done anything out of turn, the bunch of keys would come hurtling towards your face. So, and he came at my father with a knife. So my dad got out of there pretty rapid. He met my mother over Victoria Park, showing off when they were about 15. And that was it, moved in with my mother's family.
Yes, he was sort of taken in by them at court.
Yeah, he went. My mum kind of saved him, my mum's family.
You were the youngest child of how many siblings did you have?
Three, two older sisters.
Right.
Two older sisters. So my dad worked morning, noon and night. He's on the lorries. We didn't see a lot of him. My mother was the rock. She always tells a story. She said, I stayed with my dad and married him because, one, he didn't knock her about, and he worked hard and brought home and gave him the money. So, you know, she said, I was on to a winner here, you know, and they stayed together for all their life. So,
and so as the youngest of three and the only boy, how were you treated?
I was sport rotten. I was completely sport rotten. I was the golden child, and especially because I could keep the ball up many, many times.
When was that discovered, your ability with the
ball?
Well,
I started at six, and my father was still playing. My father, he always thought he was better than me. Could head the ball better than me, I'll be fair to him. One of my first memories, standing over Hackney Marshes, watching my dad play central defender, centre-back, heading it, kicking it, raining so hard, and I was so cold and so frozen, but I wasn't moving. And the whole team picked me up at the end of the game and put me in the showers to thaw me out. So I got my sister to take me to Romford Juniors, and that was my first club. I was quite physically a tall boy, even at that age, at six, so I could play for the under-9s.
Who said, and when did they say it, hold on a minute, that young lad told me he's got something?
I knew.
You
knew?
At
six.
Did you?
I knew, internally. I knew that this was for me. I couldn't vocalise it at that point, but inside I knew that this was for me.
And even at six, it was there?
Yeah, there was an internal something. I knew that I was good at this. Driven. I'm totally and utterly driven.
Let's take a break for some music.
Oh, wow, this is for my mother. Like I say, they completely give up their lives, really, and they loved every minute of my career. Absolutely loved every minute of it, and they gave so much support. Really did. So much support. And my mother passed away with bone cancer in 2000, which was extremely, extremely painful.
Yeah, that's a devastating
disease. Yeah, and she didn't deserve that.
Well,
oh, wow, I'm going. So it's for my mother. It's Sweet Caroline, Neil Diamond.
That was Neil Diamond and Sweet Caroline. You said going into that, Tony Adams, that your parents enjoyed every minute of your playing career, and indeed that was chosen for the memory of your mother. Mm. What about school? Did they make you do your lessons? Were you...
No, not really. I had the worst attendance at my school. I used to make out every Monday morning that I was a little bit unwell, and by the time it was 11 o'clock, I was up over the park and kicking a ball against a brick wall. So my education definitely suffered. My teachers used to say, actually, Tony Adams at school, he must be games lesson.
Did you like school? I mean, or just...
No, it frightened me to death, to be honest with you. I was completely... As a child, I was so scared.
What were you scared of?
Oh, everything. And fear still plays a big part of my life, but fear, insecure. I didn't like the way I looked. I didn't like the way I felt. A very insecure boy, very sensitive.
You see, I would think, obviously mistakenly, that if somebody is very good at something, especially like football, that everybody wants to be good at, then that gives you a status in school. It didn't?
I certainly didn't feel it. They did, I think, from the outside. But if one area, the football arena, I felt comfortable with. But, you put me in a classroom, I'm lost, you know. And I used to have panic attacks when they used to, in reading lessons, and the book would go round. I was terrified. I was having a complete breakdown, panic, and my heart was thumping. Oh no, I've got to read, I've got to read. So I lived in a little bit of a fantasy world. I was a big liar, you know. I kind of made up stories. I had no life tools, and I wasn't educated or learning in that area.
It's fascinating to hear you say this, especially because, well, I mean, right now you're studying for a PhD and you have other qualifications, of course, prior to that. I mean, what happened when you went back to education?
Yeah. I didn't want to be at school during, you know, my schooling days. You came at the wrong time for me. You know, I wanted to be a footballer.
And so you and your parents knew, of course, that football was the life for you, and it came down to, I mean, was it a case of trialling for different clubs, or did you have your pick of them?
I had my pick of them. Yeah, when I was about 13, I went round all the clubs and had a look.
With your dad?
With my dad. He went and got his coaching qualification. If he was going to teach me, he wanted to teach me properly. You see how addicted I was to the game.
And you say that your father took what you interestingly described as your addiction to football very seriously very early on, and he learned to coach, and your mum and dad were devoted to this idea that it was your future. What about your sisters in all of this? Did they think...
They were cheerleaders the side.
They didn't think Tony was getting too much attention?
I'm sure they did. I'm sure they've got massive resentments towards me. Massive resentments. But, you know, it was maybe a family joke. I couldn't do nothing wrong. You know, going forward into my drinking days, I don't know why I keep bringing it up, but it was part of my life. You know, when I used to wee the bed and things like this, drinking too much alcohol, she used to enable me. You know, she used to put the mattress out the window to dry it. Her son couldn't do nothing wrong.
Yeah.
You know, instead of saying, "Oh, Antonio, you've got a real problem," is I would do it with my children today. You see, you know, they didn't know no better, so I'm not having a go at them. You know, they love me. And did the best that they could. So, you know, when I went to prison, for instance, as well, they were the ones I felt really sorry for. I was stuck in a prison and I was out of the way, but they had to deal with the, you know, the shame and the disgrace I brought upon their family.
So much more of the story to come. For now, though, it's time for music. Tell me what's next. We're on track three.
I'm a massive Paul Weller fan, apart from him supporting Chelsea. I got my Sound Effect album signed for my 40th birthday. Thanks, Paul. There was a big mod revival in 78 when I was at school, when I was that little boy lost, making up stories. I thought I was the boy about town, and this is the Boy About Town by Jam.
That was The Jam and Boy About Town. Tony Adams, as a boy about town, what would you have been sporting when you were listening to The Jam? What would you have been wearing?
Sporting, I got it.
Yeah.
Well, I like the smart aspect of the, you know, the mod kind of hush puppy. I've got a pair on today. Hush puppies, and I had a boating jacket and Stay Press. I fell into that category.
Of course, it would suit you being that sort of style. It's quite an sort of obsessive, particular style, I'm thinking. No, I mean, obviously, physically it would suit you. But I'm thinking, you know, the Stay Press and the jacket and the button-down shirt is... It's precise.
Sharp.
Yeah.
Sharp.
Yeah.
Organised.
Yeah.
Yeah. Perfectionist.
Yeah.
You're
an obsessive character.
Yeah, I like things. Yeah. I can let go today on certain things, but yeah.
I'm thinking of David Beckham here, because, of course, he has, if I can use the word confessed, it seems a little melodramatic, to having those...
What's Beck's done now?
Well, not now, but a few years ago he said, yeah, you know, I like all the towels to be straight in the bathroom and the tins in a line in the larder. You know,
they've got some flash word for it today, haven't they? I
can't OCD, remember what
they call
it, isn't it?
I've got millions of those. Don't worry about that. We was comparing with Gazza on the plane in 98 before the World Cup. We was comparing how many he's got and how many I've got. But I was with a guy
in
prison.
How many what?
OCDs. You had to go three on that side, three on that side, touch his head three times, squint.
So what are you?
I was nervous. What did I have? I did jaw. All the neck goes. Did you hear that?
That was good for radio. So you used to click your neck.
Do my neck, under arches, under ladders, these type of things, you know.
Right. Okay.
It's hard work, isn't it?
That is very hard work, yeah.
Thank God I don't do all that today.
And is it true you signed for Arsenal on your 14th birthday? Is that right?
Exactly that, and signed the schoolboy forms. Yeah.
It's every father's dream, really, to have the football star son. Was he giving you advice about your playing? Was he still giving you sort of coaching tips, or did he sort of hand you over to the club?
He stepped back and let the coaches do their stuff. And because it became a profession, as soon as I left school, as quickly as I could, he went, well, this is a job now. This is grown up. Right. Occasionally, he would whisper something in my ear, and I always listened. I might not showed it, but I always listened.
Where was the drinking in all of this? Did you start drinking?
No,
early?
Nothing really. The first time I ever boozed is I broke my foot when I was 17. I broke it, my fifth metatarsal, and the guy around the corner in Park Street, he put me in plaster, and for 6 weeks, in that period, done a lot of alcoholic drinking. About 11 o'clock every day, because I couldn't go out and play football.
Yeah.
And that was the drug that I loved. It was my life, you know. It fulfilled me. But I couldn't get that. And I had the plaster on and the crutches, and it got to about 11. And
so this is 11 in the morning?
About 11 in the morning. Right. And I'd feeling really insecure and scared and frightened and panicky, really. And I thought, and I used to hobble up the local pub and get smashed.
So it was your late teens, and when your foot mended and you were back playing, the drinking then just was part of your life, was it? You just sort of combined it with training and
exactly
it with
that. From the 17, when I used it, really suppressed the feelings. Really, I think that period I didn't know about girls. I've got to say this: my first ever girl experience. I was 15, 14, and I'm keeping the ball up on my head, and I'm like 1, 2, 3, and I wanted to do hundreds on my head. But anyway, this girl's come past my house with her mate, two girls. And the other girl said, she wants to go out with you. So I put my ball down and I put it on the drive. We walked round the block, kissed her. And then she turned around and went, I don't want to go out with you anymore.
Oh.
But then it sums me up completely.
Crushing.
I got the ball and I put it back on my head and I did 100. So, and I ran girls in that period. It was just so cripplingly painful. I just didn't know how to deal with life outside of football, so I drunk.
Let's have some music then. What have we got next?
Central Line and Walking Into Sunshine. But I joined Arsenal as a professional in 83. The black guys at the club, Michael Thomas and Dave Rocastle, got me into a new underground kind of movement that was really cool and different, and no one back at school kind of knew. I kind of thought I was a bit cool and a bit different, but I probably weren't.
That was Central Line and Walking Into Sunshine. Tony Adams, I mentioned in the introduction, and indeed you mentioned a moment ago as well, that you served time in prison for drink driving. Did you smash into a wall at 70 miles an hour?
The judge said, I was out of control for the length of a football pitch, Mr. Adams.
Yes, irony in that.
Yeah.
Yes.
I was going to Singapore on tour with the Arsenal team, but I was in Rayleigh in Essex. And it was the last game of the season on the Saturday, the day before. Obviously, when football's finished, during those days, I got drunk. And then obviously not left myself enough time to get to the airport. Got in the car, went straight over an A road. And I kind of remember looking back going, Jesus Christ, I've just crossed an A road there. And completely lost control. And it was over in seconds. It went bash, 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 and ended up over this brick wall, and the rest is history.
For a lot of people, that might have been the wake-up call. Why was it not for you?
No, I loved it. You're getting to know me, but people that do know me know that I'm quite insular and quite a loner. And prison was, I got a little bit of sport, a little bit of exercise, right. 3 times a day.
Yeah.
I dropped about 7-8 pound. Muscles coming out of here, eating well, sleeping well, reading a couple of books of an evening, bit of mind, and on my own. I loved it. When that door shut, it was heaven. I know you're shaking your head here, but for some people, the outside world was scary. In there, I was happy. Because my world, don't forget, outside was hell.
Who came to visit you?
Gary Lewin, fitness coach.
Do your mum and dad come?
I can't remember them. I'm sure they did. I know there was a tearful thing at the courtroom I met my mum and dad before I got taken away to the prison. And that was tough. And I think I tried to say sorry. I remember my father came round my kitchen one day, I remember, and he sat in my kitchen and said, "Tone, they're calling you a drunk. You know, you're a drunk boy."
What did you say to him?
I kind of knew. I didn't say a word. But I didn't stop drinking. I didn't know how to stay stopped. Yeah, I didn't know at that period of my life. What I must say, when I did sober up and I took my mother and father out to make amends and to say sorry, that it was funny because my father turned around and he went, "I won't have it. I won't have it." I said, "What are you talking about, Dad?" He said, "You know, they said you had a problem with booze. You were fine. I don't know what they're talking about." So I couldn't do anything in their eyes. I don't think so.
But maybe he was happy to have that conversation with you in private, but I won't have it. People on the outside criticise.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Yeah. Let's have some music, Tony. What are we going to hear now?
Oh, well, I've been shipping around for football songs. Arsenal were part of my life from 79 to 2002, and that's probably the longest relationship I've had with anything or anybody. So it's the Arsenal's 1971 squad and good old Arsenal. Up the Gunners. The Arsenal!
That was Arsenal's 1971 squad and good old Arsenal. If there's anybody who could get away with choosing that as one of their eight, it is you, Tony Adams. You've played for England and you've captained England. How much more pressure is there when you go out there as captain?
I got more pressure when I wasn't captain. I wasn't captain during 98. Listen, I did my best and I acted like I was captain anyway, but I just thought that I could have given more. I see, I'd always been captain. I would always been the leader, as it were. So I struggle when I'm not, I think, such is my character.
Of course, you were England's team captain during Euro 96. I'm sure most people listening will remember the moment. 24 million people watching here, and they were watching England lose to Germany in the semi-finals in a penalty shootout. How did you personally deal with the devastation of losing?
I drank for the next 6 odd weeks, ending up on the 16th of August was my last drink. There was a big significant change for me in the January of that year, 96. It was the first time in my life that I didn't want to drink and I was finding myself drunk. That was the big shift for me, you know. In the January, my wife was in treatment. My mother-in-law had come round and took the kids off of me. My park bench was my sofa, you know. It was a mess, you know. I couldn't blame anybody. I couldn't blame the wife, my family, or the football, the fame, or whatever. I couldn't blame anything else. I stayed sober through the Euro 96, just focusing on football. That was my only thing. I thought, right, that's it. I just... what we call in the term white knuckling it.
Yeah, that's what. So you weren't drinking at all.
I weren't drinking during the tournament. No, personally, inside, I was scared.
Right.
We went to Hong Kong. I prepared myself physically. The lads all went to the famous dentist chair. I stayed trapped in my hotel room.
And the dentist chairs, when the guys were, and they got a lot of criticism for it at the time.
Absolutely.
There were even pictures in the press.
I was
strapped in the chair, pints down the neck.
Yeah, I knew that. If I'd gone with them, then there was no way I was going to play the tournament.
Right.
Because I'd been gone again.
Yeah. For most people, 6 days would be a binge. But you go on this 6-week binge. Mm. And where does it lead you at the end? What happens?
I can't remember. A lot of blackouts in there. I can't remember most of it. A lot of time wet in the bed and, the pigsty, which was home, you know, passing out, getting up and going to drink again.
And that leads us neatly to this track that you've chosen today. Tell me why you've chosen the Squeeze track.
Oh, well, you're right. You're very good at your job.
I do my best.
You've led me in very well. It's a particular record. When I was at the end of my drinking and I couldn't get this record out of my head. I was so paranoid. There was things come out of the cupboard, to be honest with you.
What do you mean, hallucinations?
Yeah, hallucinations. It was pretty screwed up. On one occasion, I didn't wake up. I think I used to come to in those days. And I went downstairs and I went to take this record off. I thought it was playing and it wasn't playing. You know, It was just going around in my head and over again. And my first wife at that stage had just left me. And I actually drove drunk down to a treatment centre. I'm not particularly proud of this stuff. It's just where I was in my stage of my life. I threw her into the treatment centre. She was a crack addict at that stage. And I said, get in that treatment centre and sort yourself out. But, you know, she cleaned up before me. I was still drinking. And she said, I don't want to be with you anymore. And at the time, it was devastating. It was actually, the best thing she could have ever done for me. But at the time, really painful. So this record, nice happy tune. But it's great, it's a great song, to be honest with you, irrespective of what it was going on in my head.
That was Squeeze and Black Coffee in Bed, as you say, brings back lots of memories, most of them not too good at all, Tony Adams. But we shall move on. I mean, let's talk about this clinic for sportsmen and women who are recovering addicts of any sort, is it? It could be drugs, it could be gambling, it could be alcohol.
Yeah, different flavours.
Different flavours. So it's all the same thing, right?
We think so.
And how does the clinic work?
I'm very proud of it. I'm really proud of it. It's 10 years old this year. I had 25 years football with Arsenal and then this came about. I got sober in 96, and by the time I'd been a couple of years sober, people were starting to say, well, how are you doing it? How are you doing it? What's happening? And people were asking me, so I thought, well, how do I do it? what do I do?
And the clinic is funded how?
Well, at the start, I wrote the book Addicted, which I'm also very proud of. It's the Tony Adams Day. They gave me $250,000 for that, which I gave to the charity. So I funded it. Now, I must say, I think it's 6 years the PFA have been all. They fully support us now, 100%, financially as well. And we wouldn't be here without the PFA's help. They are magnificent.
That's for the professional ex-professionals.
If you've played football at any level, you know, even if you play for Huddersfield in Div 2 for 6 months, they will stick you through the sporting chance you've got a problem.
How can we have come this far and not mention Poppy?
Oh, my God.
Who is the mother of three of your
children. I'm under orders to make sure that I'm really nice about Poppy.
Poppy and you have been...
sometimes I'm brutally honest.
Can you not be both?
I love her to death. I've got so much respect. She's an exceptional woman.
How long have you been married?
Really exceptional. Good question. Married 6 years.
Together for...
8. It feels like forever. But that's
no
in a good
all,
way.
Yes.
A good way. It's just so... But I got very, very lucky. Very lucky indeed. Like I say, she is a rare person that is very emotionally intelligent. And from talking to an emotional cripple here, and very balanced, and I strive for balance today. And she's just so together, I think.
You have three children together. You're a father of five. when she took you home to meet Mum and Dad...
I won't give you all the stories.
Were they delighted?
It's a different. Me and Poppy are very different upbringings. I remember first Christmas I ever went round there and just spending the afternoon just crying in bed, thinking, God, they're so lovely, this family. They're so like they talk to each other.
Right.
It's just so amazing. I want to be part of this family. It's lovely.
And is that the tone you try and set within your own family now?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think so. I've had a lot of time at home recently as well, so I'm super dad.
And so Super Dad is carting his wife and three children.
Load of humility today, eh?
Super Dad is carting his wife and three children off to Azerbaijan.
Yeah.
How was Poppy with that?
I wouldn't have done it without their their permission.
That's quite an adventure.
Exactly that. Adventure's the right word. It's the right time. My son's just doing his A-levels, the 18-year-old, and he's going to go travelling. My 15-year-old's at boarding school. She's going to come out for holidays, and she's fine. The three youngest are that. They're young, and the schooling's going to be absolutely fine, tutor, and I think they're going to do a couple of terms back in the UK. For me, it's a no-brainer. There's a group of guys that need to be coached, need to be led. They've just said to me, go and build a football club, which is extremely exciting. And the wife said, let's go for it.
Let's have some music. Number 7 now.
This is for my darling Poppy. She walked up the aisle in 2004 to this, and Cher Baker, and I've Never Been In Love Before.
I've never been in love before. Now all at once it's you. It's you.
That was Chet Baker and I've Never Been In Love Before. So, Tony Adams, your parents, of course, lived to see you sober, and I'm sure must have been very proud of that. Mm. But they didn't live to meet Poppy. They hadn't met your three youngest children. That must be difficult, given how far you've come in your life, that your parents didn't see that part of your life.
No, I don't see it that way. I think it would have been lovely, and my father and mother were Tony Adams fans, mm-hmm. so anything I did was good enough for them.
Yeah.
They knew me better than anybody. I got loads of, time with them. I had 4 years sober with my mother, 6 years with my father. I made a lot of amends. I bought a place in the south of France, and I did it with my dad. We built it.
Yeah,
And it's the closest that I've ever got to my father. On his deathbed, I shook his hand. He'd like, listen, you're going to make me go again, but we loved each other, We just loved each other. Please move on.
I will. I want to ask you...
I'm a tough big guy here. Come on.
Yeah, it's funny that, isn't it? Because there you are, tough big guy, handsome big guy.
Oh, I like the handsome bit.
It's
you're
true.
You're flirting with me.
you mentioned a minute ago fear. How can this high-achieving, talented, sporting hero who has turned his life around be still propelled by a sort of fear?
Well, I like to think that I'm not motivated by fear today.
Right.
But fear is still with me. All these feelings don't go away because I just don't suppress them anymore. They're still with me. So, and fear is a big one.
And what about you? You also described yourself a little while ago as I'm an insular guy. I'm imagining, of course, I'm putting on a desert island, as you know. I'm imagining maybe a little bit of you quite like the isolation.
Oh, fantastic! Yeah. And Poppy wants it. She thinks it's my dream. This is where, no people. It's perfect, absolutely perfect. I'm in heaven.
You see,
my wife wants me to get there, and I want to go there.
Your status has made you, the centre of attention. You walk into a room and the room changes. Because I tell you what, Tony Adams has just come in. Mm. Is that quite
different? I don't notice that.
Yeah, do you not notice that? Because I think for somebody who's maybe quite insular and quite shy,
I'm very comfortable with who I am today.
Right.
And that's a massive shift. So I've said a lot about Alcoholics Anonymous today, but just talking about humility is difficult. You don't make it very humble talking about it, but I try to live usefully and walk humbly under the grace of God. That's what I live by. So it's in a nutshell, really. I shouldn't say anything else, but that's what I try and do today.
Seems a good time then to ask you for your final disc. What are we going to hear?
Well, exactly, and I'm sure maybe this has been done before, but Monty Python, Always Look on the Bright Side of Life. There is a story behind this, and it's my great, it's very up proper now, the chairman, Mr. Noel Quinn, of Sunderland, Sunderland's chairman, so I have to be very respectful here. Mm-hmm. But we were great buddies, and I think we had more than one or two beers up and down the Holloway Road. He's a really cool guy. But after the one that we lost in 88, the League Cup, I went back to and I stayed in his flat in Enfield, and he introduced me to the film Life of Brian, and we must have watched it about 300 times that evening, and it just makes me smile.
Always look on the bright side of life. Always look on the light side of life. If life seems jolly rotten, there's something you've forgotten, and that's to laugh and smile and dance and sing. When you're feeling in the dumps, don't be silly chumps, just purse your lips and whistle, that's the thing.
Monty Python and Always Look on the Bright Side of Life. So, Tony, it's the point at which I'm going to give you some books. I will give you the Bible and the complete works of Shakespeare, and you're allowed to take your own book.
The book of Alcoholics Anonymous, the big blue book, would be the one. Right. Thank you very much. Enough to keep me occupied.
OK, it's yours. And a luxury as well, to make life a little more bearable.
Football.
Really?
What did you expect? Hours and hours. Back to that girl when I was keeping it on my head and trying to do 100. Maybe I'll have time to do 1,000. Who knows?
OK, it's yours, a football. And if you had to choose just one of these 8 discs to save from the waves, which one would it be?
I've just got a Monty Python, the one we've just played, I think. Yeah, it'll keep me going, I think.
OK. Tony Adams, thank you very much for letting us hear your Desert Island discs.
It's been a pleasure. Great fun.
You've been listening to a download from the BBC. You'll find more information on the Radio 4 website, bbc.co.uk/radio4.